you, to all of you for your prayers and support, to myself, my wife, and my family as we navigated through a mini crisis, health crisis, up in Cleveland, Ohio. And I was gone for 2 Sundays. It is so good to be back with you. I have looked so forward to lifting up the name of Jesus Christ in worship with you this morning. Amen? Let's stand on our feet together. And we have a scripture to read as we begin this morning. This is Zephaniah chapter 3, verse 17. Minor prophet Zephaniah chapter 3, verse 17. Let's read together. The Lord your God in your midst. Let's stop there. Where?
In your midst.
He's here. He's with us. He's in our midst today. Amen. The mighty one. Who?
Mighty.
He's mighty, isn't he? Will save. What's he going to do today?
Save.
Listen, if you're here today and you don't have a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, and you don't have your soul secured for all eternity through the redemption that he has provided, may today be the day that you put your trust in him. Amen. There is no other name given under heaven among men whereby we must be saved. Let's begin at the beginning again. The Lord your God in your midst, the mighty one will save. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you with his love. He will rejoice over you with singing. You know, that puts me in mind of the verse that talks about rejoicing in the presence of the angels in heaven when someone gets saved. The rejoicing is in their presence. It's not the angels rejoicing. It's the Lord. Amen. He's rejoicing over us in our salvation. And I can't wait to get there and hear him sing. Amen. Let's sing this morning of the first song, He is Mighty to Save.
Yeah.
Janelle, we need him every hour, every moment, don't we?
Yes.
None of us would make it. None of us could do anything apart from him.
Yes.
Just talking about that this morning with Susie. Sometimes life throws things at us that really put a big demand on us. And if it weren't for the grace of God, we wouldn't make it through. Amen. Let's sing, Lord, I Need You.
Thank you.
praise as we proclaim today your glory, your honor, your praise. We do need you. Thank you so much for your unfailing, matchless love that you lavished upon us. Thank you that with all the saints, we long, as Paul prayed so long ago for the church, that we would be able to comprehend how deep, how wide, how high, how long is the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. And thank you that because your Spirit is poured daily into our hearts, the Spirit of love, acceptance, and forgiveness, that we will, with all the saints, comprehend and walk and live in the love of God. The love of God is
lift each other up in prayer. Gary and Barb Black have asked us to remember Barb's granddaughter. She's in the Cleveland Clinic. And lift her up in prayer. That's Barb Black's granddaughter. Let's bow our heads together. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to gather here in the house of the Lord. All glory and honor to you. All praise and adoration. You're everything. You have all power and all authority and all might, all knowledge, all wisdom. You're in control and you rule with sovereignty over your throne, O God. You're ruling, watching, working in this world behind the scenes in ways that we have no idea. God is great and we honor you. We thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who gave his life on the cross, and we will remember and think on that in a few moments with the time of communion. We pray and thank you for the Holy Spirit that walks with us every day. We bring these needs to you, Lord, today. We pray, Father, for all the places in our world where there's hurt and pain and suffering. We pray you'll bring order and strength to the people in Oregon that this terrible shooting, Lord, at the community college. And we ask that you'll help as there'll be services held and churches, no doubt, with new people coming in today. And may people cry out to you, Lord. You are our hope. We just were able to share with our youth that when the heart is dark, how great is that darkness. But you said, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. We pray, Father, for those that have hearts that are darkened and living in that confusion and chaos. We pray that you'll rescue them and we will be your hands and feet to them. Comfort these families, Lord, that are hurting. We pray, Father God, for the needs listed here before us and just lift up each one to you. And ask, Father, you'll bring the healing that is needed and the comfort. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Bring the strength and the peace of God that goes beyond all understanding. And guard hearts and minds, we pray. Father, I pray you'll challenge us. You've been challenging us, Lord, about being the body of Christ. And we're in the midst of a study of being a church that truly gives the authentic love of Christ and accepts as Christ would accept and forgives. You're speaking to us, Lord, about being great for the glory of God, building a great church, built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. Building great men of God like David's mighty warriors and great women of God like Queen Esther. Great marriages, O God, that bring glory to you and mirror the image of God. This morning, Lord, we'll learn and think about building great children for the glory of God. We thank you for every person present. May we all be tuned in, Lord. May you teach us, we pray. All that's said and done, may it bring glory to you and to your honor, and may you be lifted up. Comfort those this morning that need it the most. Help us again to be your hands and feet and to be the body of Christ wherever we are at. And be Christian as your Spirit lives in us and as you motivate us and as we follow you. We ask all this together in the strong name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. You may return to your seats. I'd like to invite our ushers, our servers, if you'd come forward, and we're going to prepare for Holy Communion. So servers, please come forward. As we get ready to share in Holy Communion, as you receive the elements, hold them in your hands and be in prayer. Ask the Lord to search your heart. And if there be something in you that is not right, he will show you. And you confess that to him. Ask Him to teach you to follow Him with all your heart. You do not have to be a member of the church to receive communion. The requirement is that your faith is in Jesus Christ as your Savior. Let's have a prayer. Lord, we now prepare our hearts for this time of breaking bread together and remembering the body of Christ and drinking from the cup, remembering the blood of Christ that was shed for us. We pray that this time will not only recount all that you've done, but we will also, to our heart's content, know that you are coming again. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Humbly I come to the cross.
body of our Lord, which was broken for you, preserve you blameless unto everlasting life. Let's eat together. Thank you, Lord. The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was shed for you, the blood of the new covenant. Eat, drink, and be thankful for what Christ has done. Let's drink together. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, our only hope is in you. You're the Savior of the world. You said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Jesus, you also said that you are the gate for the sheep. You said there were false shepherds that will try to enter in a different way. And they represent the thief who comes to steal and kill and destroy. But you said that you laid down your life for the sheep. And that you have come that we may have life to the fullest. We look to you as our source of hope and joy and the only way of salvation. And the way to the Father is through you. And that way was paid with a great price. Your body that was beaten and whipped. You were hit on the head again and again with a stick. And they mocked you and spit upon you. And they took spikes and nailed them into your hands. Nailed you to the cross and into your feet. And there you hung. God's Son. For our sins. For my sins. And you atoned, and you bled, and you suffered. Thankfully, your grace was displayed because as soon as they hung you on the cross, you said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Then you said, it is finished. You said, into your hands I commit my spirit. Came down from that cross and they put you in a grave and sealed the grave and put the proper Roman guards. But death and the sting of death and the law, none of that could hold you. You rose again from the dead. And you are alive. The Bible tells us you are ever interceding at the right hand of the Father praying for us. We acknowledge you as our Savior. If there are some this morning that don't know you as Savior, you will save them if they call out to you and trust you and believe upon you. You will save them, Lord. We honor you this day. We thank you for what you've done for us. We remember. But also to our heart's joy, we know that you are returning again. The coming of our Lord Jesus Christ will be soon, and we are to be ready. We can't wait to see you, Lord, our heart's desire. But we pray that we can be faithful. We pray that we can be found working and loving and witnessing, sharing in compassion, loving those around us, praying, crying out to God, serving, rescuing. We ask, Lord God, that you'll use us for your glory, for your honor. We give you all the thanks. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And amen. Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Deborah Coley is our, well, I think most importantly, she's got a new granddaughter. Amen. Awesome. Sophia. Amen. Sophia was born this week, Chris and Caroline. So we rejoice in that. But Deborah is our Sunday School and Discipleship Ministries chairman. And that would be the Sunday School classes we have, the life group we have, men that meet on Tuesday, and the women that meet in ladies' Bible study, and groups that gather at St. Matthew's and serve, and all the ministries that involve people gathering around the Bible or serving the Lord, all the way from our nursery up through our adult ministries. And so Deborah is the chair of that. And the Lord's laid upon her heart a little presentation that she wants to share this morning. And so pay close attention. Come ahead, Deborah.
Thank you. Talking about building a great church to the glory of God.
building great women of God, great men of God, and today, and building great marriages last week, today, building great children to the glory of God. Amen? Building great children to the glory of God. Did we already take the offering?
No.
That might be important. Go ahead, just come forward if you would. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for what we've just shared. And in the areas of ministry, as the church grows and new families come in, and we desire to build this church to your glory, we pray you'll call your workers into the harvest field. People who have a great passion and love children. People who love teenagers. People who love to open up their home and show hospitality and invite people in. Call your people. We're all called to be involved, Lord. May we find that area of ministry. And now, Lord, the offering, we return to you the tithe. And we also invest in the offerings out of knowing that yours is the kingdom without end. In Jesus' name, amen. This morning, if you've already raised children, then you have a heart that children are raised to love the Lord. Amen? And you can take what is shared this morning and pray over this and pray for your children and your grandchildren as they're being raised. Building great children to the glory of God is the title of the message. Psychologist and marriage counselor Dr. James Dobson received a letter from a 9-year-old young lady named Elizabeth Christine Hayes. And she composed a letter about girls and boys and the differences between girls and boys. And the title of her letter to Dr. Dobson was, "Girls Are Better Than Boys." And I selected some of the things that she said, and here they are. Girls chew with their mouths closed. Girls are cleaner. Girls are smarter. Girls don't let stinkers as much. Girls cover their mouths when they sneeze. Girls don't pick their nose. Girls are more kinder to animals. Girls don't smell as bad. Girls don't have as much body odor. And girls go to the bathroom politely. Dr. Dobson sent that letter out to over 2 million people. And he invited boys to send their response in on their opinion of girls. And these are some of the responses from the boys. Boys don't cry and feel sorry when they kill a fly. Boys don't have to sit down every time they go. Boys are proud of their odor. Boys get to blow up more stuff. Amen. Boys eat with a lot of heart. Boys don't need to ask for directions. Now this next one, I was thinking that the boy was writing a letter, and I bet that he asked his dad, "Dad, what would you say?" And this is what I think the dad told the boy to write down. Boys don't take 2 million years to get ready. Boys couldn't care less about Barbie. Boys don't waste their life at the mall. Amen. Now this morning, I'm going to share with you 10 keys to raising great children to the glory of God.
Amen.
And as I share these, you just need to know that it is with an absolute covering of grace and mercy and some luck thrown in, and mostly time on our knees in prayer and asking God to help us as parents. Amen? And grandparents and loved ones and the church that is a part of raising children. I'm thankful for a church that really loves children and invests in the lives of children. Amen?
Amen.
So none of these things do I claim to be perfect on, and I have fallen short as you do, and there are no perfect parents. Amen?
Amen.
And there are no perfect children. Amen? And we're a work in progress, and God is helping us. 10 keys to raise great children for the glory of God. Number one, write this down, pray for it. Pray for it for your children, raising children, grandchildren, loved ones. Pray for it in our community. Pray for it in our church. Number one, a real relationship with Jesus Christ. A real relationship with Jesus Christ. Some may say, well, I bring my family to church. Isn't that the real relationship with Jesus Christ? G.K. Chesterton said, going to church doesn't make you a Christian any more than standing in your garage makes you a car. We're not talking about a religion, a man-made thing. We can have a fake form of religion. We're not referring to raising your children, grandchildren, being the church that raises children and loves children. We're not talking about duty and ritual and putting on a mask and going through motions. We're not talking about a Christian in name. We're talking about a Christian in reality. We're talking about a relationship with Jesus Christ. Dad, mom, grandparent, if you walk with the Lord, and you talk to the Lord, and you listen to the Lord, and you obey the Lord, and you have an intimate walk with Him, that is a dynamic game changer in raising children. Amen? To be a man of God, to be a man of the Word, a woman of the Word, obedient, humble, willing to say I'm sorry, being faithful, present, sensitive, a Christ-like character. The key to my life and my relationship with my spouse is when things aren't right, I go to the Lord and the Lord speaks to me. And by the grace of God, I say yes to Him. And He shows me what to do. That's having a walk with the Lord. Amen? And the greatest thing you can do is be a great man of God, a great woman of God, and you'll be able, by the grace of God, to be a part of raising great children. Philippians chapter 3, verse 10. With all these, I'll give you some verses. Philippians 3:10. I want to know Christ and experience the mighty power that raised Him from the dead. I want to suffer with Him, sharing in His death. And I think that shooting in Oregon brings new meaning to that. When someone stood and said, I am a Christian, and they were shot. Matthew 22:37 says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. Love your neighbor as yourself. Children see and feel and experience and know when you have a real relationship with Jesus Christ. Don't go through the motions. Don't go through the forms. Have a real relationship with Christ. And that is an amazing key to raising great children to the glory of God. Amen? Secondly, too, children thrive when dad and mom truly love each other. Children thrive when dad and mom truly love each other. Just a word here to single parents. God will fill that void. He has not overlooked you. And He will provide in you what your child needs to bless and help and strengthen you. We know that in life we have to juggle a lot of priorities, don't we? There's work, there's recreation, there's the repairs on the home, there's kids and church and sleep and bills to pay and deadlines and lots of things you would love to do in life. But I would say that the greatest thing that your parents can do in raising great children is make sure you get number one thing right, get your marriage right. Amen? That will have an indelible impact upon your children. That's why it is so hurtful, and that's why we lift up families that have gone through divorce. Lift them up in prayer, encourage them, and help them. We pray that God will bless the marriages and that children thrive when dads and moms truly love each other. That gives security, stability, peace. Your children go to school and they sit next to other children where their parents are going through a divorce or have been through a divorce. Children are being told lots of politically correct stuff. They're going through peer pressure. The last thing they need when they come home is parents that are fighting, yelling, disrespectful, edgy, and having a dysfunctional home. We need homes where parents truly love each other, and that'll bless the children. Deuteronomy 24:5 says this: if a man is recently married, he must not be sent to war or have any other duty laid on him. For 1 year he is to be free to stay at home and bring happiness to the wife that he has married. I think that principle is all through marriage, don't you? Parents will raise great kids as they love their daddy and love their mommy. Number three, make the Bible the heart of your home. Make the Bible the heart of your home. Many people parent on tradition, on books, on CDs, and things that they find online. How about the book that was authored by the one who created the family? We need to open up the Word of God. Can you imagine in America if dads and moms and single moms or single dads would open the Bible and gather their family and read the Word of God? You know what teaches our country? You know what teaches our children? The television, the computer, the smartphones, and the iPad. We need the Word of God to be the heart of our home. Amen? Henry Ward Beecher said, quote, "The Bible is God's chart for you to steer by, to keep you from the bottom of the sea, and to show you where the harbor is and how to reach it without running on rocks and bars." End of quote. A little girl repeating the 23rd Psalm said it this way: "The Lord is my shepherd, that's all I want." Write down Psalm 139. Psalm 139. I would encourage parents, read that, pray that, say that with your children. Teach your children to memorize that. Teach that to your grandchildren. Give them money if they memorize that. That's a great thing. It really is. Psalm 139. "Lord, you created me in the womb. You knit me together in a secret." Chuck Colson said, "The Bible, quote, the Bible has been banned, burned, and beloved. More widely read, more frequently attacked than any other book in history. Generations of intellectuals have attempted to discredit it. Dictators of every age have outlawed it and executed those who read it. Yet wet soldiers carried into battle, believing it more powerful than their weapons. Fragments of it have been smuggled into solitary prison cells and have transformed ruthless killers into gentle saints." End of quote. What could the Word of God do to your family, to your children, to your grandkids? Bless them. Psalm 119:9 says, "How can a young man stay pure? By living according to your word." Psalm 119:18. "Open my eyes that I can see the wonderful truths in your laws." I believe the Word of God should be the center of our homes. Do you, if so, say amen? Pray that when you take your walk or you drive and you go through the neighborhoods and you see house after house, ask God that the Word of God somehow get into that home. Number four, parents must be loyal and united. Parents have to be on the same page, don't they?
Yes.
Amos 3:3 in the King James Version says, "Can two walk together except they be agreed? You see, when a home is divided, there'll be a contentious battle. And children are able to see the chink in the armor. They can see it. And you should say, I back what your dad says. I back what your mother says. Children are skillful in manipulation. I know, I was one of them. Ed Asner said, raising kids is part joy and part guerrilla warfare. David Frost said, having one child makes you a parent, having two makes you a referee. Phyllis Diller gives some great advice. Always be nice to your children because they are the ones that will choose your rest home. Someone said this, having a child is like getting a tattoo on your face. You better be committed. Amen? Paul Reeser said, the biggest thing I remember is that there was no transitioning. You hit the ground diapering. Amen to that. Parents, be loyal and committed to each other. Back each other. Don't be divided. That is extremely important. And that is an extra battle in today's society where children are going from one home and then this home over on the weekend, back and forth. I would challenge the parents, before they go to the next home, over to dad or over to mom, and you say they parent completely different, and maybe they don't love the Lord or serve the Lord or back what you do, you put your hands on that child and you pray over them and ask God to protect them. Amen? Number five, protect your children. Now again, I preach this, some of you don't have children, some of you have already raised children, you think this doesn't apply. We're praying for the children that God gives us right here among us. And we are to be a church that loves the little ones. These are called, Charles Wesley called them the lambs. They are the young believers. We need to be a church that loves and reaches out to them. Number five, protect your children. You know there are a lot of lies and deceit and false prophets that are after our children. Teach them truth so they can recognize the lies. Put limits on when they get a cell phone and how much they're on the cell phone. Filter the internet. Be very cautious, parents, about sleepovers and where they go and who might touch them and the pedophiles that would be after them, including sometimes friends and relatives. Protect your children. Train them to resist and to report improper touch. Spend time with them and let them know how much you care about them. In John 10, verses 7 through 10. John 10, 7 through 10, Jesus said this, "Very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who have come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep have not listened to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. They will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the fullest." Protect your children. There's a poem called The Bridge Builder. An old man going a lone highway came at the evening, cold and gray, to a chasm vast and wide and steep, with waters rolling cold and deep. The old man crossed in the twilight dim. The sullen stream had no fears for him. But he turned when safe on the other side and build a bridge to span the tide. Old man, said a fellow pilgrim near, you are wasting your strength with building here. Your journey will end with the ending day. You never again will pass this way. You've crossed the chasm deep and wide. Why build you this bridge at eventide? The builder lifted his old gray head. Good friend, in the path I have come, he said, there followeth after me today a youth whose feet must pass this way. The chasm that was as naught to me, to that fair-haired youth may a pitfall be. He too must cross in the twilight dim. Good friend, I am building this bridge for him. We're a church building bridges to keep the children safe. Talking about children and teenagers this morning. And really, you never stop parenting, do you? 5, protect your children. Number 6, bless your children. Bless your children. The Bible says in Mark 10, verse 13 through 16. Mark 10, 13 through 16. People were bringing little children to Jesus for him to place his hands on them, but the disciples rebuked them. When Jesus saw this, he was indignant. He said to them, let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these. Truly I tell you, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it. And he took the children in his arms, placed his hands on them, and blessed them. Blessing upon your children involves time and touch and your words, your tongue. You see, time and touch. Touch is an affirmation. Don't think for a moment as your children go out of the home that they will be belittled and things that are negative and they'll face a critical society. But in the home, they need the blessing. Amen?
Amen.
Tell them that God has an amazing future for them. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future. Bless your children. Use your tongue and share with them a message of value and that they have an amazing future as they follow the Lord and the safety that you're putting out there for them. Bless your children. Say words of blessing, not words of criticism. Bless them. Amen?
Amen.
Number 7, realize or know what your child's greatest need is. Know what your child's greatest need is. And from the youngest to the oldest, including a man named Nicodemus, the greatest need according to Jesus is you must be born again. For Jesus said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. I just spoke to our teens during the Sunday school hour. We're in the Sermon on the Mount where Jesus said, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. And the children, or the teens, they shared with me various temptations and things that they face and some of the dirtiness of our heart. The only one that can clean and purify our heart and set us free is Jesus Christ. That is your child's greatest need. There's a book called Gospel-Powered Parenting. And William Farley in that book says this, I quote, most Christian parents assume that church attendance or youth group involvement equates to a new birth. Parents are naive about a new birth and its assumptions. One key reason that evangelicals often don't stand out is that the measure itself, affiliating with an evangelical Protestant congregation, is not the measure of dynamic religiosity, but simply one of affiliation. There is no shortage of religiously apathetic evangelical adolescents and adults in America. New birth is a radical change of heart that ushers in new desires, new loves, and a new direction. End of quote. Do not assume that your children are saved because they come to church. When that moment comes and God calls them, you be ready because you've been praying. And you're not asleep like Samuel, the older man. You are the one that says, Eli. Eli was an old priest. And when God came calling to Samuel, Eli didn't catch it. And we as parents pray for the salvation of your children. They are not saved because they're in the youth group. And you do not entrust the youth group to do what you should be doing in praying and praying over them and sharing with them and loving them and praying for the day that they say, Jesus Christ, forgive my sins. Come into my heart. I need you desperately.
Amen.
And they confess him as their Lord. That's your child's greatest need. That's your grandchild's greatest need. That's the greatest need for the children that come into these doors and are in this ministry of this church. If you will pray, or you will pledge to pray for the salvation of our children and teenagers, say amen.
Amen.
Don't take it for granted that your child is a Christian. They're a Christian when they've been transformed by the character of Christ. God comes calling. They have to speak. They have to be ready. Talk to them about this. Pray for them. And know that this is your child's greatest need. Number 8. The fathers need to be leaders. Ephesians 6. 1-4 says this. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise, so that it may go well with you and that you may enjoy long life on the earth. Fathers, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord. Now, single parents that are here, the power of God is with you. And I would encourage you to seek out a godly man to mentor. If you have a daughter, seek out a godly leader in some form. If it's the youth pastor, if it's myself, if it's a man in this church, you can come to me if you need a recommendation. There are men in this church that would do simply this. Meet once a month or meet twice a month with your child and take them out for a Coke and pray over them and bless them and say, I want you to know I'm here for you. I believe that there's men in this church that will be faithful to do that.
Amen.
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 Fathers need to be leaders. Number 9, love your children unconditionally. Love your children unconditionally. 1 John chapter 3, verse 1 says, see what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that we did not know Him. Look at the love of God. We just sang about it. Lavish your children with love unconditionally. That doesn't mean to be soft, and that doesn't mean to spoil them. Interesting, somebody sent me a Facebook post. I just got it this morning. On 10 totally uncool things my parents did that I'm now thankful for. I don't have time. I posted them on my Facebook. You can go on my Facebook and read them. Here they are. First, don't buy them a car. And she lists some of the cars she had to drive because she had to buy them herself, or she drove the family car. And she talks about how that'll spoil your child. 2, don't promise to pay for their college. 3, make them work for privilege. If they get privileges, they work for those privileges. 4, don't, and I'm going to read this one, don't tell them to do better than you. Here's what she says. This is fitting for Naples, Florida. I always cringe when I hear parents saying they want their kids to be able to do better than they are doing, or do better than what their parents did for them. Unless the parents in this analogy are abusive or neglectful, saying this just implies that providing food and shelter for your children isn't enough. Telling children that they need to do better undercuts a good work ethic, a loving home, and a thankful heart. My parents never implied that the simple life wasn't enough. They never disparaged their humble beginnings. They never suggested that we should be anything less than totally thankful. While neither of my parents finished college, they never suggested that it was my responsibility to do so in order to correct their mistakes. They told us to do our best, but never made it our job to improve upon theirs. Number five, don't fight their bullies. Number six, show lots of love to their dad or mom. Show lots of love. She says it a little different. You can read that on Facebook. Number seven, inundate them with scripture and scripture music. And what she says is when they traveled in the car and the music was on in the home, all of those scripture verses she now remembers and they are planted in her brain. Number eight, interview their dates. I tell you a story, but I don't have time, about what Lisa's dad did when her sister Tammy brought dates home. For some reason, he trusted me. But I'll tell you that story some other time. Number nine, charge them rent. That means if they're an adult and they move back in, you let them help see. This is what we do. And number 10, just say no to media and free speech. And she closes on number 10 with this. These are the things, let me back up. She says, I learned about the evils of the world in time just as my kids will, but in a world where 12-year-olds are twerking at cheerleader practice, I want to be unabashed at saying, nope, I'm sorry, not in my house. Is there an amen?
Amen.
No, not in my house. Love your children unconditionally. There's a book written by Robert Munsch. Many of you have probably read it. I don't have time. I would say get it. My wife's given them away to people as gifts. It's called Love You Forever. Love You Forever. And in it, it describes unconditional love. We are to be a church that loves children unconditionally. Amen? Number 10 and last, and the one that I say a huge amen to, realize that great children are a gift from God and a result of His amazing grace. Genesis 33. Verses 4 and 5. We have recorded there that there was a dispute between Jacob and Esau. It had been a long-standing dispute. We have in the Bible a family in the Bible. The dispute could have resulted in terrible bloodshed. Jacob cheated his brother Esau. And Jacob came into his adult years. And he was raising children, being a father. And we find out in Scripture that he wrestled with God and that he surrendered. It was at a place called Peniel. The Bible says the sun rose and Jacob went limping away in his hip because him and God had wrestled together. He's now on his way to meet Esau, his brother, whom he has cheated. Esau had the power to destroy Jacob. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, haven't we? We all, as imperfect parents, have made many mistakes raising our children. And you children, you've been imperfect in how you have honored your father and mother. We're all to blame. What we have recorded is that as Jacob came towards where Esau was at, the Bible says, and isn't this a picture of God? Think of the son who had the father who had the prodigal son. And you know that story is about two lost sons, isn't it? Two lost sons. I remember while in college, the chaplain preached a sermon I will never forget. And it was on the scars that were placed on the father's heart and the hurt that he felt because his son had left and the older son also was lost. Here we have in Scripture, Jacob is approaching Esau. Esau comes running, not with a sword, not with weapons, not with revenge. The Bible says in Genesis 33, Esau ran to meet Jacob. He embraced him. He threw his arms around his neck and kissed him, and they wept together. Then Esau looked up and saw the women and children, and he said, "Who are these with you?" And Jacob answered, "They are the children that God has graciously given your servant." How grateful are we that God brings little lives into our lives. Amen? Little people here at the church, the babes in Christ, the young ones. I found a poem called "The Little Chap Who Follows Me." A careful man I ought to be, a little fellow follows me. I do not dare go astray, for fear he'll go the same way. I must not madly step aside where pleasure's paths are smooth and wide, and join in wine's red revelry, a little fellow follows me. I cannot once escape his eyes, whate'er he sees me do he tries. Like me, he says he's going to be, the little chap who follows me. He thinks that I'm good and fine, believes in every word of mine. The base in me he must not see, the little chap who follows me. I must remember as I go, through summer sun and winter snow, I'm building for the years to be, a little fellow follows me. We as Christians acknowledge the value of life. We acknowledge the value of life in the womb. We rejoice when a baby is born. These two new grandchildren, Harold and Martha have, and Tim and Deborah have. We rejoice, don't we? God is good. He gives us these children, and he gives us these children for a time to be faithful stewards of what is entrusted to us. And when we hand those children back to God, we want them to be great for the glory of God. Amen? We're going to close. I'm going to invite all the children and their parents to come to the altar. If you would, right now, all children, all teenagers, come forward. If your parents are not here, you still come. Parents, come with them.
Yes.
All the teenagers, you come too. Right here at the altar. If you want to kneel, you can kneel. If you want to stand, whatever. Let's just gather around the altar. Now we've got grandparents here. We've got a church family here who loves children. Come, all of you, let's get behind these people. Let's all gather at the altar. We're going to have a closing prayer. All the rest of you, please come and stand behind them. Building great children in the glory of God. All the rest of you come and stand. Let's be a church supporting, building great children to the glory of God. Amen. Amen. Thank you for being a loving church. The church helps raise these children, don't they? We are the body of Christ. I can say to you men and women, before we pray, I grew up in a church, and you people taught me about Christ. You have been faithful. You do not know what an influence you have on these young ones. If you only knew, you'd do it all the more. So keep loving them. Let's pray. Oh Lord Jesus Christ, greatest need of our children, of our teenagers, the greatest need in all of humanity is that we come to know Jesus and love Him. We pray that for these children. We pray that their heart will always say yes to the Lord. If they stray, Your word says, raise up a child the way they should go, and when they grow older, they will not depart from it. May they continue to be reminded of the love of God and the love of His people, and may they come back by the grace of God. The Lord protect them. Protect these children. The enemy would want to steal and kill and destroy. The greatest thing these children can do is to love God with all their heart and follow Him and serve Him. Serve Him. Oh, Father, we pray for our children. We pray for the teenagers. The enemy is trying to attack them, Lord. Peer pressure, all of the various influences. Put a protection over them, oh God. And then we pray, Father, You enable the parents, the grandparents, a single mom, a single dad, an uncle that might be raising that child. Enable them and empower them, we pray, with all that is needed. Greater is He that is in you than he that is in the world. And bless, I pray, these adults in this church family as they reach out and as they love and as they hug a child and say kind things and pray and mentor a child or a teenager. May this be great to the influence of the kingdom of God. Oh Lord, we love our children. We love these youth. Just pray, Lord God, You'll do in them what only You can do. Oh, Lord, open their eyes, the eyes of their heart, that they may see the truth about Jesus. And then they follow and love Him with all of the days of their life. We bless these children. We bless them right now. May they be blessed abundantly. May the face of God shine on them. May they walk in joy and freedom and happiness in the Lord. May they live a life to the glory of God. Bless them, Lord, we pray. Remind them that You said, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope in the future." Oh Lord God, bless these children, these teenagers. We're going to give You the thanks, Lord, as they serve You and love You, and they are the mainstream of the life of this church. We will thank You and praise You for what You're doing in their lives. We ask all this together by faith in the name of Jesus Christ. And we all sit together. Amen and amen. Children, we love you. Teenagers, we love you. Adults, thank you for being faithful. God bless you. You are dismissed.